obviously is a very interesting topic. We have new high net worth families coming up now. There are founders who have exited their startups and they haven't touched even 45, 50, but they are already billionaires now. And the panel today has wealth managers, lawyers, so it's gonna be a very interesting discussion. I'm Varun Dhingra. My co-panelist Tariq, Arpita, and Shipra and Shagun. My first question will be, so we are talking about high net worth families today, and if we go back to the history, there were old SMEs or MSMEs who have accumulated wealth, and then they reached out to their chartered accountants or their lawyers to advise the investment. Now we have a dedicated wealth manager stream coming up for the management of their wealth. Having said that, the competition is also increasing because the many wealth managers, they reach out to them. So from the high net worth family's point of view, how should they actually approach the wealth manager, or how should a wealth manager should approach them? What should be the best possible avenues for them? Maybe Arpita, you can share your thoughts on that. Centrum, how do you take care of that?
Thanks, Varun. Good morning, everyone. So on the specific question of, I think the proposition that's best suited to deal with the complex requirements of large families would be family office, which also incidentally is also one of the most misunderstood concepts, not only here, everyone as well. So you have a silver card, gold card, platinum card, and then you have a family office, which is equal to a titanium card. But I think, and it's also a lot beyond the words and positioning, and actually a lot more about being able to deliver the capabilities. So if I were to just maybe take a little tangential thing to the question and just talk about what do you really mean by a, so then they're single family offices, right? I mean, they have, that's the most aligned way of creating. If they scale at a certain size, single family offices are the best way. So all these SME promoters who've come into wealth and it's of a substantial size, then nothing more aligned than having a single family office for them. The challenge being ability to retain and get the professionals excited about it. You know, it gets boring for, you know, the people who've been in the business of money management, not being able to get exposed to the scale. So single family office is part A. And then comes the multifamily office, which is the most competitive and talked about space. There are the competition, before to understand the competition of the various players, you know, you spoke about in the panel, we have a lawyer, we have a wealth manager, we have a trustee company as well. What is it that one is trying to do when you are trying to be relevant to multifamily offices? The first one is have a all-encompassing, it's a lot of words, but a holistic investment advisory based approach. Essentially multi-advisor, multi-jurisdiction, a fair bit of mix between peace of mind assets and growth assets. That's where the wealth managers become relevant, and that's where they're trying to build capabilities on the other side, which is the core side. To which also there are now a whole lot of requirements from these families on the bespoke side. So what's not available in the public market, so you have a patriarch who wants to settle the next generation and therefore is looking for a company in a specific area, and would, that's a lot more of strategic interest of him than the private market instrument. So that's the whole space on wealth management where people like us. So there is a firm ground there, and you're trying to build the adjacent spaces. The second one, and I think that very interestingly said in Tariq's introduction, on the wealth structuring side, which encompasses the entire thing about having a which is also called wealth planning, from the basic structures on succession to things like immigration planning to what is the most tax efficient one, to having a multi-jurisdictional, most of the global, most of the family office clients have a global footprint. So the UK leg, the US leg, the Dubai leg, the India leg, and having a proper structure to be able to handle that. That's where I think a whole lot of lawyers, and that's where the private line practice of most of the legal firms, and they're the partners that we work with, or trustee companies, or now the big four firms also. That's the part B, which is the wealth planning structuring side. And the part C, which is at the nascency, and it is actually a very individual skill based, which is where we're trying to build some capabilities there, is structuring is a lot about personal succession. the business governance and business succession. And the one stark fact, which I think is true globally as well, but a lot more for India, is 75% of wealth is with the SME promoters. So if you don't get your governance right, and you know, you pick up the pink paper and you read about things not going right between multi-generation, that is the single most important reason for families not being able to survive. So what is it that you do on the family business governance side? So these are really the three broad brush, very simplified areas of intervention. And the various players that you see in the market. So the, obviously the first one is wealth managers. We under, you know, there is a certain amount of firm ground that's there, and then you're building an adjacency in other spaces. And then the legal law firms, the trustee companies, the immigration specialists, the big four, come approaching it from the wealth planning side, and a few on the business governance side as well. How do we do it, or how does Centrum do it? I think the first thing is that, you know, it's good speak, it's nice to speak about this, but the ability to follow it through with execution really depends on the resource commitment that the organization has. That's A. So if you do not have the right kind of resources insourced with experience, it's going to be, it stays just that. It's a nice sales pitch. It doesn't get into client experience at all. And second is that, you know, these kind of clients, you actually will need to move from a transactional day-to-day orientation to relationship orientation. That flows right from top. So you can't have a transactional organization having a small pocket of saying that now I look at it from a DNA point of view, I look at it from a 5-10 year perspective. So the organization needs to be able to evolve and say, it's a relationship call, because it's a difficult, you know, as you started with saying, it's extremely demanding clients, over-serviced. And I just spoke about the competition is not wealth managers only. The competition is actually out there. There are 20 different, and I've not even spoken about the family confidant or the Munim. Munim is you know, I mean it from the way he handles all of this together, or the accountant who is able to do, yeah, in an informal manner all of this and more. It's very competitive. Clients are very, very demanding. And if you're not able to follow through what you've said, all of this, the clients are not going to be around.
So the clients, I have, based on my experience, I still, so whenever I advise a client on something, so they still go back to their chartered accountants.
Absolutely.
And they, yep, cross-verify everything, and that actually CA talks to me. And once the CA is satisfied, and then they proceed with the, coming back to the Shagun. So
I'll just make one comment,
yeah,
on that.
Sure, and please.
On. So you know the trick, therefore, there is not to substitute, but to complement them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Absolutely.
They've got to remain in the center. You strengthen their hands. Each of them will have a, you know, it's usually a lawyer or a consultant or a CA or an investment banker who then aligned with the family.
Yeah.
If you strengthen their hands, which they feel they continue to remain relevant, I guess that relationship works well. Try and substitute, I think that
work.
That just doesn't work.
Yeah, Shagun, what is your experience in this domain so far? It's pretty new probably for you, and then maybe you can share what challenges you have been facing in this domain.
So I think it is not only about, you know, the wealth management as a core. At the core of it, it's all about looking at the smaller problems. So if you as a person cannot solve simple problems for clients, you know, it can be as simple as, you know, someone not getting, you know, their credit card, or it can be their nominations not right, you know, someone who's not doing an asset register for a client. I personally won larger transactions or larger, what do you call, families to trust us, basis doing very, very small things. You know, it's about being there for the client. What I see wealth management as an industry is, and what we're trying to do in Legacy is, we believe that there was a culture in India where people used to have their munims and their CAs. They used to have their personal doctors who, you know, family doctors who they used to go to, and they used to have their own lawyers who they always go to. We feel that we need to be in that same frame of mind as a advisor to the client across a lot of other problems. Now, as a wealth manager, we cannot just restrict ourselves to capital markets or investments. You have to understand the tax angle, which also is solved by CA. So in a way, it has to be complementing. You also have to understand the legal angles. I mean, we've met people who've sold their companies and businesses, and you know, it's a family which is having a lot of money. Their problem is not only about investing. It is also about how do you plan their travel. You know, what is their security? What you're trying to look at? You know, when you go to a country like Africa or Dubai, what are the precautions you take for a large family? These are things which are not part of wealth management, so to say. But if you start broadening your, you know, aspect as an advisor to the family, you have to take care of a lot of things. I mean, I've seen cases where clients have come and they don't have cars booked on time, and it can be anything, you know. And the moment they feel that you're part of one of that person who understands you as a family, you will probably have access to a lot of other things. And I think that's where I feel we need to be. I mean, we want to be in that zone.
So a wealth manager will be like probably 10% of a tax practitioner, 10% of a lawyer and the club.
Yeah, why not? Then, I mean, it's, right? You need to know this. Yeah. I mean, it's a fact of life. I mean, I need to know what legal implications my client can have getting into a transaction. So let's say if someone's getting into a real estate project, if that project has some problem or he's associating with something, that particular transaction can impact him or his personal investments, which can probably create problems for the family in future. They can't maintain their lifestyle. So, you know, you need to ring fence your assets, which is where understanding trust services, legal angle, or tax angles are very, very important. So,
and we have been talking about trust services in this conversation. Tariq, what has been your experience? You work with many family offices regularly. What challenges do you think that those family offices have now when they have ample opportunities available for investment? And what structure you can suggest to them?
See, like what Arpita very rightly said, this is not a one-time sale. It's a long-term relationship building activity that you have to really do with the client. I mean, we've been catering to clients for the last 7 years with Amircorp now. And we've come across multiple different situations and different challenges. One or a few of them are the most common ones is when you're trying to educate the client on the entire succession plan. He's okay with the whole idea of setting up a trust. He's okay with the whole idea. He wants asset protection. He wants multiple other ring fencing tools to be taken into consideration. He wants all of that. But when it comes to relinquishment of control, that's the time when it hits a roadblock. I mean, the patriarch is still very keen on maintaining control with him. And how do you draw a line between relinquishment and control? So that becomes a bit of a challenge at times. There are other set of families who, like for example, right now we're dealing with a very large family where they want to go for listing. So one of the promoters or one of the patriarchs says that he wants to go for listing, whereas the other family members are too close to the business and they're not keen on getting the company listed. So getting into a family constitution, getting all of them into a same page, getting consent from all family members, trying to bridge the gap between business and family and business, by itself is a long-run activity. So it's not, again, a one-time product sale that you've done to the client. This is going to run into a couple of months or probably a year also to jot down the entire constitution and jot down the entire services and getting consent of all of them. Then you've got another set of families who just hear about these jargons. I want to do a trust. I want to do a constitution. I want to do a business governance. They don't know the full background about it. They don't know the full understanding about it, but they just hear these jargons, and then they say that this is what I want to do. How much ever you explain them, educate them, they're still not mentally there. They form trusts, they form constitutions, but when you look back at them after 6 months for a revision, the patriarch is still managing the control. He's still where he had left it earlier. So after doing the entire exercise of forming a trust, forming a constitution, they've still not started using it. They've still not changed their lifestyles or changed the way the constitution says, or the younger generation is still struggling to get control of the wealth. The elder generation is still taking all the shots. So there are multiple obstacles that come your way, and this is an ongoing activity that keeps revision, keep revising over a period of time and improvising as time goes by, because the family dynamics also change with time. The family requirements also change with time. So this is not something that can be done one time and forgotten about. You need to continue working on it with the family and continue revising the structures to fulfill the needs of the family that changes over a period of time.
So lawyers probably play a key role here. Whenever there is a family deadlock where a father wants something and a son wants something, or a brother wants different, I'm sure you would have faced so many cases in your career where this deadlock came in, wealth advisor proposed something, trustee came in, but ultimately the deadlock was still there. So he said 1 year, it can take 1 year. So is there a legal angle attached to it? Can we actually resolve it, or the only option is to solve it over a dinner table?
No, that's a very good point. In fact, I was thinking about the same point itself. So like Tariq mentioned, one of the biggest complexities or biggest issues we find as lawyers is the difference of opinion between an elder generation and the next generation. And while the patriarch or the matriarch would want to sort of retain their business values and their family values in the structure going forward, the younger generation may not have the same sort of values or may think slightly differently. So it's important for us to see where both views converge or both generations converge at a midpoint. And as lawyers, our role, of course, is firstly to understand. So honestly, the entire process, I feel, is very client-driven. It is for the client to tell us what they want from it. And once we understand from both generations' perspective, it is our role to sort of lay it down in terms of documentation. You know, for example, we've had clients, like Tariq was saying, we have one family we've been advising on their wealth structure for, it's been nearly 1 or 2 years now. And every time we talk to them, there's a new angle that comes up. So I think as lawyers, it's important to stitch everything together and lead to a situation where, you know, both generations are happy and the entire arrangement is also correct from a legal perspective. So I think my co-panelists were mentioning, in a trust structure, technically the patriarch or the matriarch will sort of let go of control, because in a trust structure, the trustee is the legal and beneficial owner of the assets. The assets could be your business or your businesses or your entities. So then how does this play out? How do we ensure that there is certain amount of guidance or certain amount of, I wouldn't say control, but certain amount of guidance that the promoters still have in the entire structure? Because today, in India at least, businesses are very promoter driven and controlled by promoters. So to that extent, we also try and see whether, you know, at a company level, we can ensure that, say, the directors and employees, the roles of the directors and employees are laid out. And, you know, in a family constitution, we can ensure that going forward, the businesses will be governed in a certain manner. If there's an exit between, you know, two branches of a family, how will that be governed? For example, the patriarch will say that, you know, exit should not happen. That is just not an option. Two brothers cannot separate. Then how do we then sort of understand from the family's perspective that, you know, yes, exits may happen, but the first step should be mediation. The two branches should sit and decide that, you know, over a course of 6 months that, you know, whether or not we can work together or not, or whether or not exit is the correct way of doing things. Second thing is in terms of liquidity. If there is an exit, where is the money coming from? Are you going to buy, is one family member going to buy the other one out? So these are the questions that come up, and from a legal angle, we need to think it through as to how to document it in a manner that is that has legal sanctity.
So the complexity, based on my experience, complexity is getting increased day by day. So a promoter started a company, and the brothers sent their next generation to the US for higher education, and this next generation is not coming back. Now, Shagun, are there investment opportunities for them? Like the promoters can continue running their business, but they also put their money in different avenues where the next generation starts getting certain regular income. Are there diversification available apart from the regular mutual fund or the regular stock market investment?
There are enough and more diversifications options available. What we've seen is, and we are dealing with such cases where large HNI families have kids who are studying in US. I know of someone whose kid is not in US, he's in India, but he's a musician, and you know that family.
That's another complexity now.
So it's a completely different genre he's gone into, and you know whether he's going to stop pursuing it, the answer is no. So the families are planning to do is trying to gear up their kids in a way to educate them along with the wealth advisors, so to say. So we do a lot of internal training with these kids, and they come to our office, they work with us, they understand. So we basically, the parents are trying to give them some kind of flexibility to manage their own money in the way they want, and they're letting them to take those risks. And over a period of time, they will understand how, you know, this is important for them to understand. Whether they want to get into new businesses or some other, just to keep this portfolio as it is. I mean, that's the call which they will take over a period of time. But I think the parents have started handholding to an extent with the wealth advisors or, you know, group of their councils available to get this going for their family.
So this is very interesting to note. So at Legacy, they are doing personalized training. So at Centrum, do you also manage that personal relationship with the client, or it's more of a, how do you actually diversify the investment portfolio? Like a personalized service, or?
It obviously has to be a personalized service. Yeah. Especially in that segment of client, there is no one size fit all. If I were to oversimplify the situation and say that there are typically two or three client segments that are there. So one would be the, you know, I think someone started out with saying the inheritors, and you know the exact point Shagun mentioned, that a lot of time the second generation is just not excited about what their parents created. They want to build, they want to create a legacy of their own, or they just don't want to be in that space. It's too overwhelming for the patriarch for him to get control, and for the new generation to make space for themselves. In my experience, that is a kind, so those kind of portfolios are a lot more peace of mind portfolios, a lot more, preservation is a lot more important than the growth and the risk assets. And there, the next generation, if they are not very actively involved in business, actually are taking a huge amount of interest in managing money. And there's a very detailed next generation, equipping them on how to handle this, because there's always a new flavor in the month and there's a new exotic idea in the private market, which is very, very exciting. But how do you actually, you've come into wealth that you weren't sort of prepared for. So this sort of clientele is actually a lot more focused on capital preservation, and which is an important priority for everyone, but risk assets a lot lower here. And then obviously the set of clients who've come into money in their early 40s and have tremendous amount of money that's got created in first generation entrepreneurs in the businesses that they created, a lot more open to seeding and supporting other entrepreneurs, and a lot more open to private markets. So the approach for that, while there is those kind of clients at that life stage are not very excited about being able to maintain it, because the psyche is, I've got a whole lot of years ahead of me. I want to support entrepreneurs like myself who came into money. So the approach depends on the kind of family that you're dealing with. But, conventional sounds boring, but that's the bedrock of portfolio creation. Private is interesting, although globally, I was just hearing at the Global CFA seminar that the first time in the US, the absolute amount of money that went in private markets was more than public markets. Mm-hmm. So it's really catching on, and that's coming in from patient sources of capital as well. So on the alternate side, on the real estate side, on the long short side, on the mezz debt side, structured debt side, versus the straightforward long only options, and there are very many of them. So that really depends on the, there is a learning curve the next generation needs to go through, and obviously, that's where the engagement sort of starts with them.
So as we speak today, my mind is actually working very fast. It's giving me more complexities now. So you said preservation of wealth. So what if I'm a promoter? I am totally busy in running my business. My next generation is not in India, or a musician, and I have to preserve my wealth. So this question now is open to the forum. I don't have time to manage my investments now. Is there a trust structure which I can do, or is there a legal angle, or any?
You know, before you get into delivering it through a trust structure or through the appropriate, I think the first thing, the clients not being able to have time is the most common situation. Very few people who have actually monetized have a whole lot of time in their hands to manage the portfolio. Spend time on something called an IPS, which is investment policy statement. What you're essentially doing is you're developing a framework which requires the whole family to sort of come together and then use that to measure and monitor. So what is it that you expect from the portfolio? What are the risk controls, audits, the concentration limits across everything? That needs to be, and you know, I heard, you don't sit out of an asset class completely if you have a negative view. So there's a strategic, which is core, and then the tactical shading can happen. All of that gets captured in the IPS, or the technicality apart, a framework. that framework is where you need to have a significant amount of communication, post which, you know, is trust the right structure? Is a private limited company the right structure for it? You know, how much can you go in private? How much can you go in public markets? All of that gets designed. So time poor clients is what it is. That's not an exception. But if you're able to get an agreement on the framework, life is a lot simpler. And on both sides, the expectations are on a similar background.
Okay. Can you suggest a couple of maybe framework for the larger audience?
Sure.
Of course, we are not asking for a legal opinion, but broadly, what broadly options are available?
So I think the word that's been floating around is of course, a trust structure, which I think happens to be the most common succession planning vehicle that is used in India. I think the complexities are really around the trust structure itself. Now, if we come to a trust structure, the way a trust works is that there is a trustee who, and there are three parties. There is a settlor who puts in the money into the trust or the assets into the trust. There is a trustee who is a legal and beneficial owner of the trust property. However, the trustee holds the trust property for the benefit of the beneficiaries, who are, say, the promoter and his family, which is generally the case. So now, as we were mentioning, in terms of letting go of control, so as such, the trustee is the person or is the entity which will have legal and beneficial ownership. So technically, if the trust owns assets, all the assets are technically the property of the trustee. So then the question comes, who is the trustee? Now, like Arpita was mentioning, people are not very, so if your assets are, say, liquid assets and you're not, and the promoter's not very keen on managing these assets, so then you could think of an institutional trustee, which could be a bank. Or if your assets are, say, your own companies or your own businesses, then you would want to manage these assets in your individual capacities. Another interesting structure we've seen is something called a PTC or a private trust company, which is essentially where the trustee itself is a company, and on the company's board sit the decision makers or the promoters of the family. So that's an interesting structure which I think has come up. And I think it's also very interesting because it sort of preserves the identity of the trustee separate from the beneficiaries who could also be the promoters. So from a legal standpoint, the trustee is actually a company which has a separate legal identity from the beneficiaries, which are actually the promoters. So I think that's another interesting structure that we've seen. Now, in terms of the different types of trusts, I think there are two main categories the way we lawyers look at it. One is a discretionary trust and one is a determinate trust. Now, in a discretionary trust, what happens is that the trustee will have the discretion in terms of what kind of income or corpus belongs to each of the beneficiaries and what is the share of each of the beneficiaries if and when the trustee decides to distribute certain income or assets to the beneficiaries. So basically, the discretion lies with the trustee. The other format we've seen is a determinate trust where the shares and what percentage of interest each beneficiary will have is already predetermined in the trust document itself. So I think these are the two variants of the of types of trusts we've seen. And
okay, Arpita, I wanted to share one experience and maybe see Centrum delivers that kind of product. So I met an IT Bombay 1970s batch guy, and he set up a business. His father set up a business, then he joined that business. It was a private company, took it to the stock market, now is a listed company. But he still has something in his heart that he was not ready for that business. He still takes it to the next level. Now he wants to come up with some innovative ideas. Maybe it can be investment in a startup, it can be investment in a REIT, and he has a constant complaint that his wealth manager doesn't have a product for him. So do we have some innovative product for a new generation or maybe new budding entrepreneurs who have got millions of dollars now?
Yeah, I'm sure. so yes, from...
like a REIT maybe or some... So Centrum has
REIT
some...
REIT is a pooling. So you know what happens is the pooled structures which offer a huge benefit on diversification are not exciting enough for clients a lot of times. So people want to be very specifically sure of what they're getting into. So a lot of families like this, I'm not too sure if that becomes a bedrock of full investment, but you know, there are a lot of clients that we have on high growth companies, either early stage or after they've received some amount of markup. You know, so one of the first families which developed the electric vehicles, they were putting in sponsors seed capital and were willing to take certain money from friends and family. We did it for a whole lot of tech-listed companies right now for... So that's an exciting space, and you know what, and it works for the promoter as well, because you're not ripe enough for a large institutional investor. A lot of times it takes away a lot of your rights. So it works both ways. HNI is a pool of capital there, as a provider of capital, and companies who are not at that stage that they want to give up their rights. So both on mezz funding and both on the startup. But I think, it's more a fad. You've got to be really very, very clear of the investment rationale and the company's ability to scale up beyond what
so
you see.
So let's not add to more complexity to their life. They are already complex, right?
No, but there is a requirement. There is a requirement for sure. There are a lot of clients. A lot of time it's also about your area of interest. You know, if I've been in an FMCG and I want to backward integrate into a similar area, I want to, on that three specific things and technologies that I understand better, I want companies to be hunted down and, you know, look at, see if there is a meeting of mine. But I think one has to be a little careful because a lot of them are very interesting ideas without a proof of execution. HNIs have been a very patient source of capital, but it's not a one-stroke thing. You've got to be able to diligence the idea very well before you take it to the client.
Yeah, sure. I think there should not be such situation in the first place. I mean, there are so many products available in the market and so many options to invest. So I don't know who's the wealth manager. If you let us know, we'll give them the options. But yeah, coming back to the IPS part, yeah, it ultimately boils down to the due diligence and whether it's really a strategic fit or, you know, it's a relevant investment option for the family or no.
Okay. But one very important part around all of this is, as much as we're getting ideas in terms of new investments and new opportunities, is how you structure it around it, because your existing businesses are already there. You need not need to risk your existing business. You need to demarcate and create an arm's length distance by structuring your new investment ideas in such a way where there's no liability that falls on you. Yeah. I mean, whereas your intention is to grow the wealth and grow the money, you've got a very good opportunity to invest into. But you structure it in such a way that it doesn't hamper you or your existing wealth in any manner. So creating that arm's length distance becomes very important.
Yeah, that's a very important consideration, actually. A lot of clients, when you're getting into newer areas, you will be raising capital. And you want to ring fence what you've created so far from a capital structure point of view as well as you get into. So, yeah. You know.
So maybe we can take a couple of questions from the audience if anyone has anything to ask in particular.
Hi, I'm Sumit. You've talked about structures and how they can be used for succession planning for many of these wealthy people. Now, I do not know, you may be able to help us with a number that at X level of wealth, it makes sense for anybody to get into this structure because of the cost involved in either creating it or maintaining it. Now, what is that level? And has there been any thinking that by using technology, can we bring it to a significantly lower level? Because though the HNI, ultra HNI is growing at a faster rate, but then there is a middle class, which people define it in different manner, who would either need this service 10 years down the line, and maybe as a business guy, I might have a reason to capture them today and probably provide a service at a far significantly lower level. So any thoughts on this?
Maybe Tariq, that's a wonderful question because that gives birth to a new startup, right? So if you have an easy structure available.
One is that we've already made a perception that these structures are expensive to manage. Okay, and it should only be done by an ultra high network individual or an HNI may not be able to afford it. There are different solutions for different families. So it doesn't matter on how much wealth you have. Will you be using a trust structure or will you be doing a plain vanilla will? It all depends on what is the complexity of the family and which solution will fit for you. So advisory around that is important, whether we do not take a decision right away that let's set up a trust for this guy or let's go and sell a trust to him. It really doesn't happen that way. You go ahead and service the client. You try and understand what his needs are. You understand what tools will fulfill his needs. Like Arpita said in one of her conversations where maybe an LLP would work for him. Maybe a private limited company will work for him. Maybe a solution gets addressed through a trust only. Or maybe his, a plain vanilla will may work for him. So depending on what tools are used for the client to fulfill his objectives is what we should look at. and not just jump into a solution that let's do a trust for him.
But actually, he, I think, wanted to ask, is there a number attached to it, let's say 100 crore plus wealth or a 50 crore or a 1,000 crore plus? Can we still?
I think that is more of an intimidation by, I mean, people just have this notion that trust is only for HNIs or something like that. I mean, as he rightly said, will is something which, you know, if you see India, probably most of the people will not even have a will, and you can just go to NSDL site or probably any of your bank site or insurance company sites, you will see ready-made will available. So it's not very difficult to even draft a will, you know. So it's very, very easy.
Yeah, so, you know, I think just to add to what Shagun mentioned, so from the size of the, you know, the number that you started out with, is there a number? And second, important, very important dimension Tariq brought in was complexity. So even if it's not a very high ultra net worth family but has a special child in the family whose needs have to be looked after the parent, you probably need a structure which outlives the provider of amenities for that child. And I think Shagun brought in a very important point on which is the, you know, it's also an awkward conversation there, right? Wills really don't cost anything. That's culturally we're not, you know, it's a difficult, I've had very, very savvy clients say, why don't you bring this up with my father, because I'm not sure how to bring, you know, start that conversation, or if I talk about it, I think that's going to be really very, very awkward. But the fact of the matter is that if you do not have a will, is not only about, so if you do not have a will, the personal succession laws take over, which is completely I don't know if I should be using the word crazy. There's a lawyer also out here. There's an Indian Succession Act. There's a Hindu Succession Act. The Muslim Sharia is a combination of these three. There is a there's a very different way, the way Goan properties are sell. You know, rest of the country is common. There's a certain jurisdiction which is civil, and then there is a Sharia which. So you know, if something were to happen to me, I don't have a will. The way a woman's asset will be dealt with is very different from how a Hindu male's asset will be dealt with.
Yeah.
So one is a decisioning which may go out completely different from what you planned out to be. And second is the administration, you know. So even if it's a nuclear family, if you don't have a document which clearly shows a movement of title of property, the paperwork on that and court ke chakkar later is just not worth it. So I don't think it's only about the ultra, and obviously you don't want to have a solution. Trust is not a solution for every single question. But succession, pure wills, a lot of people, even now a lot of very savvy clients assume that if you have a nominee, you know, a nominee does not create a beneficial ownership, except in a few cases which have also gone in for, there's some sort of a case law precedent on that. You assume that if I have a nominee or I have a joint holder, I have taken care of my succession problems. So one, apart from that size, complexity makes a lot of important part as well. But simple things like having a bare bone, a will, handling your common succession issues and all that is a must for all of us. Actually, everyone here as well. So it's not the purview only of ultra HNI families in a manner of speaking. Trust does, however, unless it's it does need a certain amount of. So that trusts also are, I think Shipra alluded to that, the two kind of structures that are there, oversimplifying, but the families who want ring fencing. So, you know, you worry about inheritance taxes, you worry about giving your personal guarantees out, you know, you worry about getting into a new line of business which may erode already the capital that you'd created, which is a lot more about giving up control and distancing yourself. And then the second set, which is more about succession and keeping the assets together. I have created a huge amount of wealth, but I don't know if my next generation will fritter it away. So I want it to be kept together.
So it gives us probably, so if we speak for another 3 hours, we'll have another 300 complexities available. So actually, I would like to thank to Aditya that now we have a team to resolve all those complexities. So we have to take a pause here because the event has to go on. If anyone has questions, maybe can take offline. Aditya, so, okay.
Yeah, I think I just realized you've crazily exceeded the time limit. So my apologies for that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all the panelists. I would like to invite